Today's scripture reading comes from John chapter 9, verses 1 through 12 and verses 35 through 41. As he passed by, he saw a man blind from birth, and his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he would be born blind?" Jesus answered, "It was neither that this man sinned nor his parents, but it was so that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle and applied the clay to his eyes and said to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which is translated sent. So he went away and washed and came back seeing. Therefore, the neighbors and those who previously saw him as a beggar were saying, "Is not this the one who used to sit and beg?" Others were saying, "This is he." Still, others were saying, "No, but he's like him." He kept saying, "I am the one." So they were saying to him, "How then were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man who is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' So I went away and washed, and I received sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." Jesus heard that they had put him out, and finding him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "Who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have both seen him, and he is the one who is talking with you." And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. And Jesus said, "For judgment I came into this world, so that those who do not see may see, and that those who see may become blind." Those of the Pharisees who were with him heard these things and said to him, "We are not blind too, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would have no sin. But since you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." This is the word of God.
Today, the word that I'm sharing is about spiritual sight. Now, seeing is it's not mysterious, but at the same time, it is very mysterious, especially when you think about things that you don't see, things that you don't notice, blind spots. Are they there? Do we have blind spots? Yes. Every single person in this room has blind spots because we're not God. God sees everything. So definitely that's 100% yes. But what's in there? And the only answer you can give is, "I don't know. Something's in there, but I'm not sure what it is." And so sight, especially spiritual sight, can be a little bit difficult. But praise the Lord, we have help. Amen? We have help. We've been doing Alpha Marriage. And for a lot of couples in Alpha Marriage, they're saying it's been difficult. Why? Because you have to talk to your spouse. And you have to talk to them about things that maybe you don't want to talk about, like difficulties and whatnot. And I tell people, you know what? I understand. Why? Because teaching Alpha Marriage has been difficult for my spouse and myself as well. And, you know, we're doing date nights, we're looking over the material, and, you know, a couple times within the last 6 weeks during our date night, we just get in a fight. You know, as we're getting ready for Alpha Marriage, because one of the homeworks was, let's talk about something that, you know, you've been wanting to talk about. And my wife, so we're at this restaurant, literally this is like the best, beef noodle place I've ever been to in the United States. And I was there, and it was so delicious. I was so happy. And then, you know, we start talking, and she goes, "You know what? You really have a problem with interrupting people." And I was like, then we started talking, and I was like, you know, and as whenever I get criticized, especially by my wife, I become analytical. "So do you mean rarely, sometimes, often, always, what do you mean? And how do I interrupt people? And so we're talking, and she's like, you know, it's not like you just jump in the middle of the sentence, but you're like, it seems like you're such in a hurry. Like whenever I'm talking and you don't wait till I finish my sentence. And that's because I know you. I know what you're gonna say. You know, and we have this connection. She's like, no. That's not how it works. And she goes, you even interrupt other people. I'm like, really? And then my thought's like, we've been married 20 years and you've waited this long to tell me this? And then it's like, is this true? Is this right? And she's like, go ask your friends. And I was like, I will. I will. And so I went and I asked my friend, we're talking, you know, chilling, talking, and you know, and then I was just like, hey, do I interrupt people? And he's like, yes. You know, it's not that he interrupted me in the middle of my sentence, but he came in so fast and hot. I was like, a little taken aback, you know, but you know, what that proves is what? Like, that helped me kind of understand. It helped me understand. You know, there's things that we don't see. And praise the Lord, we have people around us. And we should have people around us that can tell us about things that we don't see. Because that's the way it's supposed to be. And that's the way that actually God works. You know, today's passage is about blindness, physical, and actually most of the passage is actually about spiritual blindness. It's a story of a man who was blind from birth in John chapter 9. We didn't have time to read the whole thing, but, you know, go back, you could read the whole chapter. It's about him. And he's doing what he usually does, asking for alms. And his Jesus' disciples see him, and they know that somehow that he's blind from birth, and they're like, why is he blind? Is it because of his sin, or is it because of his parents' sin? And Jesus gives an interesting answer. He says, it was neither that this man sinned nor his parents, but it was so that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Amen. So we see that there's blindness, and that this blindness is actually about the work of God. And he talks about darkness and day, and he says that I am the light of the world. So when he says that, we understand that he's the light of the world. What does that mean? He's helping people see. He's helping us see. And that's what this passage is about. But this passage, I think, why was this man born blind? And it says that it's for the work of God to be displayed. I don't know about you, but it's a little difficult for me to swallow. It makes me uncomfortable. Why? Because I think, what about him? You know, all those years of struggle and hardship. And yeah, it's for the work of God, but again, I think, what about him? And I think maybe it's a cultural thing, but we think, like, he didn't have a choice. Like, that idea of having a choice and kind of being responsible or whatever it is, it kind of bugs us. He didn't seem like he had a choice. And even the idea that God's work comes through suffering, it's a little bit difficult to swallow, because we don't want to minimize people's pain, right? Like when you see someone going through a hard time, the last thing you want to say is what? Oh, don't worry, God's doing something here. Do you know what I mean? We don't want to say that. Jesus can say that. I don't want to say that. You know what I mean? And so there's certain things like that. That's why Paul says, when he talks about pain, generally he talks about it this way, his own pain, right? Now I rejoice in my suffering. for your sake. And in my flesh, I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of this body, that is the church. You know, that I guess we have to accept that suffering has a place. If we don't believe that good can come out of suffering, then that's completely antithetical to our faith. The suffering of Christ for his church is the foundation of our salvation. And Paul, in this verse, says it's an honor for me to be suffering for other people's sake. So it seems true that suffering is a part of the work of God. Maybe another reason why we don't like to think about suffering in that way is because we feel sorry for people who are suffering, right? But people are not necessarily exactly what you think they are, right? And for instance, I remember many years back, I brought a student with me here at our church, and we're going to people's houses, and we're having meals, you know, a lot of meeting people, and it was great. It was a great time. But I remember noticing, you know, the student's shoes. I brought them with me, and I'm like, dude, your shoes, they look kind of crazy. I mean, there are a lot of holes and things like that. I was like, and he's like, no, I just like these shoes. And then, like, a few days later, a dear sister of our church came to me and brought, like, a box of Nike shoes. And she goes, you know, I want you to give this to that student. You know, and I was like, as soon as I saw the shoes, and as soon as she said that, I was like, I know exactly what you're thinking, but it's not true. You know, because what she was thinking, oh, he's a poor kid and he can't afford shoes. You know, but I accepted. I was like, oh, thank you. Thank you for being so generous and thoughtful. And I just went back and I started yelling at him, because you know why? His family's really wealthy. His father is an orthopedic surgeon. And people are giving him shoes because they think he's so poor. Misplaced sympathy. Do you know what I mean? I think we do that. Sometimes we do that. People are not necessarily what they seem. Once I remember I was praying for and counseling this young man. He was in his 30s, and I know he just recently lost his job. And, you know, and I was like, oh, are you okay? You know, are you going to be okay financially? And then he turned to me and said, yeah, Pastor, it is rough, but I think I have enough savings for about a year. I could probably survive a year. And I just looked at him. I was like, I suddenly felt sorry for myself. A year? You could go without. And I was like, man, you should be giving seminars. 30s, you could go a year without a job. It's pretty amazing. That's kind of, I feel like that's what's happening in this passage. In John chapter 9, you know, it talks a lot about this person. I would say we get to know him in a way that we just don't know really any other follower of Jesus Christ. Let's see what he's like. In verse 17, it says, so they said to the blind man again, what do you say about him since he opened your eyes? And he says this. He said, Jesus is a prophet. He's already making declarations of faith. In 24, he says, so for the second time, they called the man who had been blind and said to him, give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. 25, he says, then he answered, whether he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see. He's like testifying. 27, they keep on asking him about Jesus, and he says, he answered them, I told you already, and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you not want to become his disciples too, do you? Like, he's feisty, right? I don't think we remember any other disciples in the Gospels being feisty towards the Pharisees. This blind man that just got healed, there's something in him. There's something in him. Verse 32, never since the world, he begins to preach, never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. And then the Pharisees had enough. They answered him, you are born in utter sin, and would you teach us? And they cast him out. He's feisty. There's something different about this man who was born blind, who many, I believe, would think would be so timid, maybe weak, maybe shy. But in this passage, he's fierce. He reacts in a way that other disciples in the Gospels never did. He's courageous. He's willing to stand toe-to-toe with Pharisees. So his physical blindness, it didn't mean that he was weak. It didn't mean that he was weak. His faith was more tenacious than all the other disciples. Why so much detail? What's going on here? This is a picture of like spiritual, like kingdom reversal. That's why Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. There is something about God's work that kind of stands the standards of the world on its head. And Jesus, through this passage, he's showing us what real spiritual sight is. In 35, Jesus heard that they cast him out, so this is right after, cast this blind fellow out, and having found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, and who is he, sir, that I may believe in him? Can you see like the difference in tone when he was talking to the Pharisees and when he's talking to Jesus? Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you. He said, Lord, I believe, and he worshiped him. Jesus said, for judgment I came into this world that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind. And so, what is spiritual sight? We see here that there is a willingness to trust and humbly obey the Lord. There's a willingness of heart. And many of us, I think, when we think about our own lives, that many times when we think back to our faith journey, that many times it was those actually times that we struggled, when there's pain and when there's difficulties in our lives, when we actually became the most faithful. We actually leaned upon the Lord. Those times of health complications, that's when we cried out the loudest, when there was no insurance and you know things were on the line, and that's when we came before God and we cried out to him. Why is that? Because God meets us in our weakness, amen. He meets us in our weakness. Not that we want to suffer. No, nobody wants to. But there's a special grace in our lives when we do suffer. And it's palpable. You can sense it. Recently, I've been spending some time this week, a lot of time this week with Pastor Eddie and Pastor Mark. And, you know, we've been friends for so long, 30 years even. And just watching them kind of wrestling and going through what they're going through, you would think that they would be down, but it's completely the opposite. You know, as you spend time with them, you feel so encouraged. You know, as they share and what God is doing, you feel so encouraged. And I'm sure that the people who have had opportunities to do that, you sense that. There's a special grace upon their lives as they're going through these things. So let's not look down or feel sorry for people who are suffering. Some of them may be in a much better place than us, you know, because there is a grace that God pours out onto people's lives. So that's spiritual sight. But what's spiritual blindness? Now, there's an opposite spectrum from this situation, that there's people in these scriptures, the Pharisees, and this in these scriptures, they're generally called the Jews. And it's not talking about all Jews. It's just a term that John uses to describe the leadership or the Pharisees. What are they like? Okay, I believe that they're a picture of spiritual blindness. The Jews did not believe it of him, that the person was healed, that he had been blind and had received sight until they called the parents of the very one who had received his sight. Cynicism. 24, so a second time they called the man who had been blind and said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." We know what Jesus is about. Assumptions. 26, so they said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" Verse 27, he answered them, "I told you already, and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again?" We can see that spiritual blindness is a matter of a hardened heart. These men have made a decision about Jesus, and they're looking for evidence to back up their view. They were the religious leaders, and they made a decision not to believe. Okay, and everyone has their reasons for not believing, even in the face of miracles. And this is why they chose not to believe. If we let him go on like this, all men will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. They would lose position. They would lose status. They didn't want to follow Jesus. They don't want to submit to Jesus. So spiritual blindness is an unwillingness to listen or change despite what God or anyone else says. You know, there's times when I feel like we all know what this feels like. You know, in our own lives, and even when I do some counseling and when I see, you know, sometimes there's so much bitterness or anger or unforgiveness. You could see in people's eyes, "I would rather die than change. I'm not gonna let him win. I'm not gonna let her win. I'd rather die than change." You know, like, you want interruption? I'll give you interruption. You know, there is every one of us, there's something in us, I think, that can get to that place. A hardness, like a calcification of our souls. But you know, maybe not changing is dying. You know, maybe not changing is the dying. I don't know if you've ever touched a dead body before, but if you do, you notice that it's cold and hard. And that's what we become in our spiritual blindness, cold and hard. So how do we go from being blind to having sight? This is so interesting to me, this verse right here. When he had said this, he spat on the ground, okay, made clay of the spittle, and applied the clay to his eyes, and said to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which is translated sent. So he went away and washed and came back seeing. Now, I think most people get caught on like, he spit and made mud and put it on this guy's eyes. Most people kind of get caught on that. But I get caught on, he told a blind man to go find a pool. I get caught on that one. And he didn't say, Peter, go help him out. Go find this pool. And it's sent. The name is sent. So he sends him to a pool called Sent, right? There's meaning there. You know, there's many different ways that Jesus heals, but in this instance, it seemed like he made him do something that maybe wasn't that easy for him. Wasn't that easy. His healing came through his obedience. His healing required participation. That's an interesting thing in obedience. The thing which he was told to do, you know, and it doesn't even seem like it would work. I'm sure this man who was blind from birth, he's washed his face enough times in his life. I'm sure he's walked here, done this many times before. I'm sure he's done it. But even though he's done things a lot, he still obeys Jesus. He obeys him anyway. So how do we become people who have sight? There has to be a submission. And even in doing something that you don't think, I think, will work. But you do it because of obedience and truth. You know? Maybe having a difficult conversation. In my heart, it's like, I know what he will say. I know what she will say. You know, when you're facing a difficult relationship, I know, I've tried this before. It doesn't work. That might be what's ringing in your ears. But Jesus is saying, go, I send you. And so we need to go. We need to obey. We need to have that date night that may erupt into an argument. You know, so we have to connect with that family member that makes us, we don't know, it could go either way. You know, when I call this person up, it could go either way. You know, we have to pray again for a friend. We have to pray again. Maybe a prayer that we've prayed before. But that is what people do who want to have spiritual sight. There's this thing called the Johari window. And this is more about self-knowledge or self-sight. But this is an interesting look at all of who we are. So top left corner is the open. That's everyone knows. You know, other people know about yourself. That's top left corner. Top right corner is your blind spot. Other people know, you don't know. And you realize this through feedback, right? You need a feedback loop to help you get knowledgeable about your blind spots. Bottom left is a hidden area. You know, and other people don't know. How does the light come in here? Through self-disclosure, and you become known. And the bottom right is unknown to everyone, including yourself. And these are things that you discover together as a community. Our spiritual life and spiritual sight is not just about you and God. It generally happens with God through his people. And so the idea of coming together as a people and we giving, us giving people permission to speak into our life, that's essential for people to be able to see. And I hope we understand that. We should know that. And that's where we come together to wrestle and to be changed by Him. And that's what the church is about. We worship and we love worship and we love the Word. But where is that person that you can call, that you can talk to, that can speak, that you can ask tough questions, and that person can respond and tell you the way it is? That is what a life-giving community is all about. And so, in conclusion here, the spiritual sight, okay, this is not just just a momentary thing. I think it's a spiritual attitude. It's a spiritual attitude that the Word of God and God is telling us that we need. How do we know that? Because in verse 40 it says, those of the Pharisees who were with him heard these things and said to him, we are not blind too, are we? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But since you say, we see, your sin remains. There's an attitude. If you say, you see, you're clear, you see it all, that's the attitude of blindness. But what God calls us to do is to admit. And the Pharisees come very close here. We are not blind too, are we? They come close. But an understanding that there are things that we can't see, that there are difficulties. You know, do you ever feel lost? Do you sometimes feel like you're not sure where God is taking you? You're not ready to do something, but you got to do it anyway. There's times when you may feel like kind of not sure and lost in that way. And this is when we're called to come to God and come to this community. You know, there's been many times in my life in ministry where, like, what is going on? What's going to happen? I don't know. And when things are very difficult, and I remember in those times, I would call certain friends. And, you know, I remember just very vividly eating Korean barbecue and just sitting there and just like tears rolling down my face, because I knew that things are going to be hard. I knew that things will be difficult in life and ministry. I could just kind of sense things coming in that direction, and it was. And it wasn't, there's not a lot of things that are easy sometimes. But in the midst of that, I had friends, a few, that would be with me and understand and to pray and to seek together. And that's what a life-giving community is. My prayer is that Southland would be a place that all of us as brothers and sisters can come together in humble, life-giving relationships, seeking to love and obey the Lord. Amen. Amen. Let's come together in prayer.